name is Rick Roberts. This is a continuation of our interviews known as Legends of the New Haven County Bar Association. And it's my pleasure today to be speaking with Penny Mason. Hello, Penny.
Hello, Rick.
This is actually so much fun for me because honestly, most of the interviewees are my friends and I consider Penny a friend for many years. Penny actually is from Virginia and went to college in Maryland at Goucher College. Took some time off as a mom and did some other interesting things she's going to tell us about. Then went to some unknown law school. I think it rhymes with fail. Oh, Yale Law School here in New Haven, and has been in New Haven ever since. Most of her career has been with the now defunct Tyler Cooper and Alcon, and we all know those who have been practicing for a while as a giant in the New Haven County Bar, and then left with a group, the New Haven group of Tyler Cooper, to go to LeClaire Ryan, and for the last few years has been with Barclay Damon. Penny's done primarily employment, some malpractice work. She also represents doctors and lawyers in administrative hearings. She's been a long-standing, very active member of our Bar Association, former president, and just won the Lifetime Achievement Award, very well deserved. And I'm just going to say on behalf of Legends that we picked her before we even knew that she was going to win that award. So I think that's just shows how well we're picking them. But anyway, with that, Penny, welcome.
Thank you, Rick. I'm delighted to be here, actually, and humbled and kind of amazed at this whole thing, but it's great. I'm delighted to have you interview.
Oh, that's kind. Thank you. Well, it's reserved judgment until the end. we were just chatting before, sort of off camera, and you were telling me a little bit about some of the work you did before law school, which got you interested in law school. Maybe you could share that with us again.
Sure. I actually went right from finishing my undergraduate degree to law school. But while I was finishing my undergraduate degree over a 9-year period, because I'd gotten married after freshman year in at Randolph-Macon Women's College, I took a one course a semester until I finished my sophomore year. Took 9 years. We were in the Baltimore area, and I went to Goucher College and then ended up there full time my senior year. So while I was taking those one courses a semester, I was getting involved in some, in addition to having two kids, I was involved in an environmental group, the Delaware Council for Clean Air, which is associated with the American Lung Association, I think it was. And then in addition to environmental groups, I was interested in some other nonprofit interests. As I was finishing my senior year at Goucher College, I really wasn't ready to stop going to school, but didn't know what career I wanted to have. And so my husband, practical person as he was or still is, said, well, make a list of pros and cons of all different kinds of occupations. And so when I came to lawyer, there was kind of a gut reaction to that. Caused me to remember people that I was around when I was growing up. One was former Judge Dalton, who ran for governor of Virginia a couple times. Didn't win, but his son, Johnny, did. Anyway, I had fond memories of those people. And so I decided to apply to law school. And then the next question was, well, where do you go? What school is worth moving the family from the Baltimore area, and where my first husband had a good job in advertising? So those were Harvard, Yale, and Stanford, and Stanford's too far away from family. So I applied to University of Maryland School of Law in Baltimore and got in there. And I got in other places that I had applied to and visited and decided that Yale was the place where I felt most comfortable based on my gut reaction again. So the family moved up here, and I had planned to teach law at a Danforth fellowship that was paying for a combination PhD and law degree, because Danforth pays for PhDs. I convinced them to pay for my joint degree, a PhD in sociology and law school, and this is going on too long, but working after my second year at Tyler Cooper Grant Bowerman Keefe, I had such a good experience with them and decided that I wanted to drop the joint degree situation and just graduate with a law degree. And fortunately, the firm felt the same about me, because they gave me an offer after my second year. And the Danforth Fellowship did not ask, the foundation didn't ask for their money back. So that was good too. But so I went straight from college to law school, and then law school to Tyler Cooper. And that was a much longer answer than you're looking for.
No, no, it's a great answer. That Danforth's not related to Fred, is it?
They're related. And they're defunct now, because they couldn't keep convincing people to teach, to get PhDs and teach, because mm-hmm. they're having trouble. A lot of young PhDs were marrying PhDs, and they were having trouble placing them all in the same cities, so forth. Anyway, they're now defunct, but for a long time, they paid a lot of money.
That's pretty cool, though. I had no idea they even had such a joint degree. And I mean, I wish I had a degree in sociology. That probably come in more handy than my law school training, I'd say.
Yeah.
You do. Were you thinking about teaching then? Was that sort of
the time? Yeah, I was thinking about teaching law. After spending a summer with a really nice group of people, my decision was, not only did I not want to teach it, I wanted to practice law, but I wanted to practice with these people. I mean, that, right. With the emphasis on these people, it was, they were just great. And
well,
some of them are still around with me.
I remember when you were given the Lifetime Achievement Award, Liz Acey introduced you as another friend of mine. I was a young lawyer way beyond when I should have been a young lawyer. So I overlap with her a little bit when I was probably about 40. And she kindly and accurately described you as a wonderful mentor. So I guess you've had that chance to kind of teach probably, you know, in the various iterations of Tyler Cooper, and you're kind of known to be a terrific mentor. How have you enjoyed that part of your professional life?
Well, that just came naturally. I mean, in Liz's case, I recognized her as a good lawyer right off the bat, and a good friend. And it's not like she needed a whole lot of help from me. I have done some teaching. I've worked at Yale's trial practice, and a number of folks that you've interviewed have done that. Maybe some of them still are, but that's fun, and that's, you know, really the only teaching that I've done, which I have enjoyed. But mentoring, as I say, just kind of came naturally. There are a couple of others that I have mentored, not only women, but a couple of others have gone on to other firms and done very well, and we've stayed friends. I've enjoyed that.
And have you? I mean, if you had to sort of, as you're looking back on your career, which is actually, you might be one of the few interviewees, because I didn't know you had some time off, who has been doing this for a shorter time than I have. I've been doing it 38 years. You're 35. How long you been doing
it? No. So my bio says 35 years, but that's how long I litigated the medical malpractice defense cases.
I see.
Okay. Cases. Since then. So I've been in practice for 43 years.
Okay, there you go. So I was going to ask you, as a woman graduating then in the 70s, right? Out of law school?
Yeah.
I mean, when I was kind of just getting about even when I was getting out the law school class, but you were one of the, I guess, probably the younger women who was doing civil litigation in Connecticut. I know you're probably a little vintage, Alice Bruno. I know she was another, she was actually someone who, she actually is the one that got me involved in the Bar Association, by the way.
I think I got her involved, I have to say.
Oh, there you go. It's a big happy circle.
Another mentee, actually, I have to say. And we made her a partner when she was in the hospital with her first child.
How was that? I mean, did you find it difficult being one of the few women in that universe?
Not really. And I'm sure that I'm a little bit of an exception. And the reason I say not really is because I grew up with an older brother and hung out with him and his friends all the time. And so just being around boys, guys, men was natural for me. And I recognized some sexism among judges and maybe some other lawyers, but not most lawyers were really very kind. And judges came around as their daughters grew up and started becoming professionals, and they kind of figured it out by that point.
Interesting. Speaking of sexism, I did forget to mention that you also are an investigator of sexual misconduct in Title IX claims. How long have you been doing that? And tell me how that experience has been.
Well, that's been very interesting. And that's sort of what I landed in when I decided I had lost the fire in the belly for litigation. And you got to have it, as I'm sure you know. So when that happened to me, I said, well, geez, I guess I should retire because I don't want to try cases anymore. And so fortunately, my friends in the firm said, no, you don't need to retire. Figure something else out to do as a lawyer. So as it happened, I was asked to be a fact finder for Yale's university-wide committee on sexual misconduct. And that was really interesting. I did that for 6 years, and I would investigate. So the committee would give me a case to investigate, and that meant sort of finding out all the facts related to the case, interviewing witnesses, the complainant and the respondent, and any witnesses that they suggested. And the good part about that was that I would do this work and write a report, but I didn't have to make the judgment. That was the report went to the committee. So,
but you're making a recommendation. You're giving a recommendation.
Well, I didn't give a recommendation actually on whether or not they had violated the rules. That was up to the reviewing committee. But I might have had some comments about the credibility of some of the witnesses or the complainant or the respondent, and I would have made those, if I felt strongly about it and had a reason for it, I would put that in my report. But that's as close as I came to recommending a judgment.
Are you still doing that?
I'm not doing it for Yale anymore. That ended a couple of years ago. And since then, I've done some Title IX investigations for the University of Hartford. And I helped with an investigation at the University of New Haven. And then some of the, the Boston Globe spotlight folks who did the expose of the priests. After that, they focused on sex misconduct in private secondary schools, starting in Massachusetts, and then they worked their way into Connecticut. And so some private secondary schools asked me to help with interviewing members of the community. Because when this was going on, the smart schools reached out to everyone in their community, alumni, faculty, present students, former students, and asked them if they'd had any experience that made them uncomfortable. And so when anyone came forward, I would, along with some other lawyers for the schools, help out with those investigations. I've been a judge for a Title IX.
Okay. Okay. So that's also, so you're pretty well familiar with all aspects of it then.
Well, I wouldn't say all aspects of it and pretty familiar, but yeah, I'm working on it. I've written some alerts about the Department of Education's edicts and then withdrawal of edicts to colleges and universities.
So. It must be, a delicate situation to interview a subject or a victim of alleged sexual misconduct, because you don't want them to relive. You don't want to, poke that PTSD button, but you still have to derive specific facts. So how have you reached that balance?
Well, it just, it comes with, I guess, empathy and understanding of what folks have gone through or claim to have gone through. And I think I worked on not re-traumatizing them, but I talked to the person about it and about that issue and made sure they were comfortable with our interview setting and situation. And when I wrote up my interview, I would share it with the witness and ask the witness to add anything they wanted to add or change anything or add some more witnesses that they hadn't told me about. So yeah, I mean, that was a concern. And but I don't think I had anybody upset about it. Mm-hmm. At least not that I heard.
Sure. Well, I mean, I'm sure, knowing you as I have for many years, I'm sure you are appropriately empathetic and sensitive and delicate. And that's why no one's asking me to do any Title IX interviews. So you mentioned something earlier I wanted to circle back to about the fire in the belly. And I was going to ask you some of the things you've enjoyed about, law / your specific litigation practice and things you haven't. So I'm going to start off with things you haven't enjoyed, since you mentioned the fire in the belly may not be there anymore after your years of doing it.
Okay. So what was negative about it?
What
caused me to decide, like, I didn't want to do it anymore?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, at the time that I made that decision, or I felt that way, I had several large cases, one an employment case, one a medical malpractice case. And one of those, the opposing lawyer was really, really obnoxious and made arguments that just to accusing me of wrongdoing and in person, when she would see me, she would act like we were best friends. And it's like, how can you go to court and accuse me of this, that, or the other bad conduct? And her client was very unreasonable. And she, so bad as she was, she didn't have any control over her client. And my client was a group of physicians who all felt like they were lawyers, and I really enjoyed working with them, except that they just made it hard. I guess I shouldn't say I did enjoy working with them to a point. So that was one case, and then the medical malpractice case, the lawyer was somewhat unreasonable, the client was not, the lawyer couldn't control the client. And my client was just not particularly helpful. And I just said, I don't need to do this anymore. And I don't love it anymore. What I loved about, I'm going to jump into the next question.
Sure. Right? Well, that's where I was going. By the way, yeah. Can I just add before you go on?
Yeah.
I just took a 2-day deposition in a very involved construction litigation case. And I mean, I The deponent, who is an owner of this very nice home in Fairfield County, just, you know, would not let me even ask a question. I mean, interrupted me constantly. Even her lawyer was finally just telling her, please let him finish the question, and then wouldn't answer a question. You know, the way experts, that they have that expert class 101, don't answer yes or no. And it gets, you know, I was thinking, this is very draining. I mean, and I'm used to it, and I still toughing it out, but it really can sap the energy out of you. But anyway, go on. I know exactly.
Yeah. I totally agree. Yeah, I had a construction case one time, and one of the deponents wouldn't answer anything. I don't know. And that was ridiculous because he clearly didn't know. But anyway, what I enjoyed about employment cases was getting to know the businesses that were the clients, just, you know, the curiosity about how things are made and how things work. And that's the kind of stuff you have to learn if you're going to represent the client well. And I enjoyed that very much. And then with the medical malpractice matters, I really enjoyed the science and digging into the medicine. And so by the time I was ready to try a case, with the help of my defendant physician and the experts, I knew as much about this one little piece of medicine as anybody did, including the expert and the doctor. And the doctors would say that sometimes a little reluctantly and say, no, you know, I had no idea that you could learn this stuff. But, you know, it's not that hard when you just have to look at one little, you know, medical procedure and know everything you need to know about it. And
you have people really explaining it to you who are the experts, which helps also.
And yeah, absolutely. Oh, yeah. I mean, there are teachers in this stuff, no matter what side you're on.
So that's one thing you've liked about litigation and I guess practicing law in general. I was going to ask you also how you feel the practice of law has changed in your some 43 years. Any thoughts on that?
Well, it's definitely changed in that we don't know each other as well. Because I think, as I said the other night, we don't have short calendar to hang, you know, we don't hang around the court anymore, which is sort of important to get to know each other. And when you know the lawyer on the other side, things work out much easier than when you were working with a stranger or someone you haven't gotten to know on a sort of a, if not a super personal basis, at least you know who people are and how sure. They practice. Certainly there are more women in the practice and on the bench and in the whole community, legal community. What else has it changed? I think people might be a little less civil than when I started out, setting aside any sexism or other things that might have just rolled off of me. But I think that the little bit of lack of civility or reduction in civility has had to do with the fact that we don't see each other around. So
it's amazing. I've done, I don't know, 8 of these, and I will say there's a certain common theme in people of our, you know, of our sort of generation seeing that and short calendar and the trial call of the calendar, just not being glommed into the same room is one reason. I think thankfully the Bar Association is still thriving, as we saw even a couple hundred people, even in what's still sort of a COVID situation, going to the annual meeting where you receive the award. So it's kind of nice to see the bar. And I mean, New Haven is special, as we know. And tell me what role the Bar Association's played in your career, Penny.
Well, as I think I said the other night, it sort of enabled me to get to know the lawyers in our community and to take on some leadership roles and, you know, get people together to do CLEs and just some socializing, which is the bench bar things that we've done, lunch with a judge, all these different things get us together. And that's due to the Bar Association's efforts and the officers over the years, including yourself. And it's just been, and it continues to do that, have that function of getting us together, helping us know each other. And that's some leadership training, that kind of thing.
The one thing I've noticed, and it's not critical of the bar, but I see fewer younger lawyers at yeah. all events. And I mean, frankly, for me, I want to see my old friends.
Yeah, exactly.
That doesn't bother me.
Me too.
Because that's why I'm going. I mean, I'm going mostly because I really have a lot of friends that I miss, especially post-COVID. But it's too bad because, I mean, getting involved in New Haven Young Lawyers, again, Alice recruiting me was one of the best things I did in my professional career. It kept me plugged me into the CBA, to the ABA, the Connecticut Defense Lawyers, DRI. I've done a lot of stuff, and that's how I got to know Liz through DRI a little bit. And I mean, it's just, you know, DRI and ABA Young Lawyers actually. But so it's been really important for me, and it's almost too bad that I can't convince younger lawyers in my firm to get as well.
Well, they have different priorities in their home lives. I mean, and in work-life balance, and they don't put up with some stuff that we put up with, which, I mean, it's hard That's to criticize fair. Them for those decisions, but I mean, well, I wish we could find a way to get them involved. It's partly a millennial thing, and I don't want to bash millennials, but it's something that that I think is a factor. And then the next, the Gen Z is even, you know, they look at millennials as like, those guys are, you know, they're no longer cool. So we have our work cut out for us to get younger people involved. But we do have a few on the executive committee who are my stepson's age and friends of his. And so I know them through that relationship. And now it continues to the Bar Association, which is neat. And if we can get them to recruit some friends of theirs, that would help.
Absolutely. I think that, again, the bar has done a really good job, but I think it's just, it maybe isn't as much a part of firm cultures. Mm-hmm. And I think you put the nail on the head about it is, they have different priorities. I mean, it's funny when my young lawyer career spanned many years, as I said, and towards the end, I suddenly began seeing seminars on work-life balance. And I'm like, I don't remember that popping up when I was in my 20s. And yeah, now I guess it's exactly. All the rage. It's all the rage. Yeah. Right. So speaking of, you know, it's funny you mentioned, you know, the fire in your belly and these difficult lawyers, because I've always perceived you as to almost be such a calming presence, which is unusual in the litigation world. And I like to think that I'm pretty civil in cases, but no one's ever accused me of having a calming presence. And I think you seem to just, maybe it's your Southern slight drawl or your, I don't know, you just have a sort of an easygoingness to you that I think maybe, have you found that that's worked for you over the years?
Yes, and I've had people notice that, and clients in particular have noticed that my style is low-key, but I get results. And I enjoy that, you know, enjoy being told that, and I have worked on that, actually, being the person in the room who knows the most about the case, but also, and that enables me to be civil and not get riled up because, you know, I've got it. I've got what I need. I mean, that sounds That sounds a bit conceited, but
I think it's accurate. It's like a secret weapon almost.
You know? Yeah, right. I mean, actually, the Connecticut Bar Association recognized me in 2016 with the Professionalism Award, which I thought, you know, at the time I said, this is the Nobel Prize for lawyers.
No, you well deserved. I should have mentioned that. I omitted that in your.
Okay. But I guess, I'm not shy. I'll bring it up.
Well, you know, just keep listing your credentials, Penny, for goodness sakes. But I mean, interestingly, when you won this award, I was thinking, well, now I guess you can't win the Yale Safran, you know, Civility Award because you probably have been, you know, a shoo-in for that also. But anyway, just in we're kind of beyond our time already, but just do you have any thoughts, tips for young lawyers? I always ask people, do you sort of urge your kids to go to law school? Do you discourage them? And you can answer any and all of that, however you choose.
Well, I wouldn't encourage or discourage. I would listen to what they were interested in doing. And if they said they want to go to law school, I'd be all in to encourage, but they're going to do what they want to do. And you know, so I wouldn't, but I would encourage them if they felt they really wanted to be there and wanted to do that. Because I remember being in law school and being 9 years older than my peers, and some of them wondering why they're there. You know, they're there because they didn't like the sight of blood, or they didn't know what to do after college. And I knew why I was there, because I'd had some life experience in the meantime. And so, you know, it seems to me for law school and then a career in lawyering after that, one needs to know why one's doing it.
Mm-hmm. And as far as just, you know, again, it's, I don't want to put you on the spot, but if you had some advice, some advice for younger lawyers, what would you tell them?
Well, I think I would say to get involved in the Bar Association, because it's really good for them. I think I said that the other night. And at the same time, I want the older folks like you, Rick. How do you like that? You're an older folk. Stay involved, because we all need each other. And so that's what I would say to younger lawyers. I would also say to do your homework when you're getting ready to do a case, and then you can be civil.
Good way.
And you can talk you can convince your clients that you don't have to be, you don't have to burn the bridges and you know, take everything by storm in order to succeed as a lawyer.
Or be the loudest voice in the room, so to speak.
Exactly.
But, well, anyway, Penny, it's been a real delight to speak with you, and appreciate your time and congratulations.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. I'm humbled by it. And it was fun to talk to you.